Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Fayette Presbyterian Church on this Lord's Day. We are glad you are here, whether you are in person or worshiping with us virtually. We are glad that you are here and hope you experience the love of God among God's people on this day. A few announcements as we begin our worship today. First, two things to tell on myself, but one thing to say that I got right. I got the hymn numbers in the bulletin this week. I'm so proud of me. They're all correct. That being said, I still don't know how to use the printer without help, so I know it's upside down, flipped around. I will eventually get it correct if somebody helps me. And then secondly, our scripture lesson today will be from John 4, 16 through 21, not John 3, 16 through 24. That was a great sermon I preached last week on that text. Unfortunately, with the power of YouTube and Facebook, if you missed it, you can go back and get it. But today, I've actually written a sermon on 1 John 4, 16 through 21. We will be celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper today, and elements have been given out. If you did not receive those, please just raise your hand and someone will bring those to you. And if you're in your home, we encourage you to gather the elements there to participate in that sacrament with us. Once again, I am thankful to those who are serving as liturgists today, and if you would like to serve as liturgist with us, simply let me know and we'll get a calendar and a rotation going. But it is good to be in the Lord's house on this day. Let us turn our hearts and minds to worship God.
Join me in our responsive call to worship.
God's love.
Those who abide in love, abide in God, and God abides in them.
We love because God first loved us.
Those who abide in love, abide in God, and God abides in us.
Our first hymn today is I Come with Joy, hymn number 507.
Do what you hear.
from the dead, Jesus Christ longs for us to know life in all its fullness, offering us renewal and refreshment, hope and forgiveness. Let us trust in the promise of Easter as we make our confession. Join me in our unison prayer of confession. Merciful God,
in Jesus, our risen Lord,
we have seen your glory,
yet in our sinfulness, on the lost path of life of Christ,
we are quick to accuse and slow to confess.
We find fault easily in others,
while ignoring our own shortcomings. We have squandered your gifts.
We have turned from your ways.
We have ignored your word. Have mercy on us, compassionate God. Pour out your Holy Spirit on our sinful lives.
Wash us with your blood
and cleanse us with your grace.
Day by day, we might be closer to the people you would have us be.
Continue your prayers in silence. The resurrection of Jesus shows us the grace of God is stronger than death, and the love of God has no boundary. This is good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Gracious God, illumine these words by your Spirit, that we might hear what you would have us hear and do who you would us be. For the sake of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. Amen. The first scripture reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 23. And this morning I'll be using the King James Version, the one you're so familiar with. So if you'd like to follow along, please feel welcome. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The second scripture reading is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 16 through 21. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so we are in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whosoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters, are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen, cannot love God. The commandment we have from him is this: Those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good and gracious God, we ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, that they might be acceptable in your sight, you who are our strength and our redeemer. In Christ, amen. Are you familiar with the old comic strip, Peanuts, by the comic and sometimes theologian Charles Schulz? You know, better known as Charlie Brown. It's one of my favorites. I was recently reminded of it when the local high school did a production of the musical, You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. It brought me back to my college years when I was Linus in that very production. I was told that my rendition of Linus's number, My Blanket and Me, with all of my dancing and my dive across the stage to get the blanket I thought I could leave behind, that it was Tony Award winning and I should head to Broadway. Of course, they may have simply been trying to get me out of Clinton, South Carolina. I'm not sure. One scene from the Charlie Brown movie that comes on every Christmas, you know, that 30-minute special, A Charlie Brown Christmas, has good old Charlie Brown visiting Lucy at her 5-cent psychiatric help stand. 5 cents, that's a deal. Now, I know my description of this encounter won't do it justice, but with the magic of the internet and YouTube, I'll have Sydney put a link on it, you know, in the comment section under the video. But I'm not going to have her do it now, because some of you would just immediately go there and start wandering through YouTube videos and not listen to me anymore. But in this scene, Charlie Brown is visiting Lucy, and after paying his nickel, Charlie Brown admits to struggling with fears. Lucy Van Pelt says, "Are you afraid of responsibility, Charlie Brown? If you are, then you have hypogluthophobia." Charlie Brown says, "Well, I don't think that's quite it. How about cats, Charlie Brown? Are you afraid of cats? If you are, you have aleurophobia." "Well, I don't like cats a whole lot, but I'm not sure that's it." "Well, are you afraid of staircases? If you are, then you have climacophobia. Maybe you have thalassophobia, that's the fear of ocean. Or graphophobia, that's the fear of crossing bridges. Or maybe pantophobia. Do you think you have pantophobia, Charlie Brown?" "Pantophobia? Why, Charlie, that's the fear of everything." And with that, Charlie Brown says, "That's it. That's what I have." In today's text from 1 John, which is a continuation of last week's text, and honestly sounded so much like last week's text that I went back to be sure I wasn't reading the wrong lectionary passage as I prepared for this sermon, and thus forgot to change it in the bulletin. In this text, we discover John has even more to say about love. But one particular part of this, it stuck out to me. I thought it was something that I needed to hear, and perhaps you needed to hear as well. So I hope we'll take a few minutes to examine this particular part of this scripture, because I think it'll help you and me and Charlie Brown to grow in our understanding of God's call as faithful disciples in this time and place. John makes the statement that perfect love casts out fear. It's fascinating to me that John doesn't say what type of fear, or necessarily what we should be afraid of, or who we should be afraid of. Instead, if you go back to the Greek, he uses the word phobos. This word phobos is the etymological core root of all of our English words that end in phobia. Though it's not pantophobia, which comes along a good deal later when folks start classifying fears, I think that's what John had in mind. Just like Peter says that love covers a multitude of sins, it seems John is saying love overcomes a multitude of fears. I love how Eugene Peterson says it in his interpretation of the text from the Message. He translates it this way: there is no room in love for fear. Well-formed love banishes fear. Now, we all know fear, don't we? It's not long that we're out of the room and we're taught to fear things. Don't touch that. It's hot clay. You don't touch fire. You don't put your hand in boiling water. You stay away from the stove altogether. Don't run across the street without looking both ways. You better be afraid because there's a car that could be coming. You should fear climbing up too high in that tree, Clay, because you may fall and break your arm or your neck. Now, these types of fears are good and healthy. However, it's not long before those fears move on to other things. You know, fear of trying out for anything. You don't want to try out for the basketball team. You may not be good enough. You don't want to turn in that artwork to the show. It may not get picked. The fear of trying. And then you get to the fear of things different than us, and the fear of punishment. Just wait till your dad gets home. The fear of love for getting a broken heart, and even sadly, the fear of God. Now, we would like to think that that last statement of fearing God is some sort of crazy talk. Fear or loving God? Why would anyone fear God? And yet the truth is, all of us who walk this planet, if we are honest, can admit to a little bit of fear of God. I mean, if you ever thought things like, how can I be sure that God really loves me? Or maybe in your nightmares you wonder, well, what if God placed all of the sins of my life on some giant big screen movie projector? And there's a vote, like on those reality TV shows, to see if I get into the kingdom of heaven or I get voted off the island. How would I ever live the humiliation of that? The Apostle Paul even struggles with this when he asks in one of my favorite passages of all of Scripture in 2 Corinthians, he wonders, how do I know that God's grace is sufficient even for me? This is certainly part of the fears that John is pointing to. Fear was prevalent in the religions of the day. The gods came to the world in order to punish the wicked. The fear of punishment, the fear of not measuring up. And sadly, we in the church have been good at continuing this, haven't we? We have pushed that fear of damnation, of needing God's salvation simply to avoid and escape hell. The church has often preached fear over love and grace, telling us to fear God and act out of this fear, as if fear would somehow make us better disciples. Friends, I don't believe that's true. I don't believe it's the message of the gospel. What I do believe is this message often makes us miserable disciples. I think I remember the first time I came across this juxtaposition. It was in middle school. The teacher asked us to get out that basal literature textbook, you know, it weighed about 7 pounds. Sadly, those things are becoming a thing of the past as we move on to digital resources. But on that day in eighth grade literature, I opened up to the story or to the reading by Jonathan Edwards. It was his sermon. Perhaps you have read it or heard it. Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. I still remember it. Perhaps you do too. If you don't, Edwards gives a description of God as the Punisher. He is vividly trying to teach his listeners about the horrors of hell, the dangers of sin, and the terrors of being among the lost. Edwards was clear, I mean crystal clear, of our need to follow Christ and beg for forgiveness. I still remember to this day reading it silently and hearing our teacher read it aloud, especially this paragraph, which scared me pretty good. He, and by he's referring to God, he holds you over the pit of hell, much in the same way one holds a spider or some loaf of insect over the fire. He abhors you and is dreadfully provoked. His wrath towards you burns like fire. He looks upon you as worthy of nothing else but to be cast into the fire of damnation. Now, if that doesn't cause you some kind of fear, I'm not even sure Halloween movies or Freddy Krueger or Friday the 13th will do much for you. And sadly, so many people suffer with such a fear of ultimate punishment that they struggle with even the concept about the truth of God's love and grace found in Jesus. Friends, sometimes I think we need to leave here each Sunday and shout Paul's words up and down the street that we find at the end of Romans 8, proclaiming that there is nothing in all creation, nothing in life or in death that can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus the Lord. If we understand God's perfect love for us, if we have that same perfect love in us by the Spirit of God, whom God has given to us, then we need not fear judgment. And if we need not fear judgment by God, then certainly we do not need to fear the things of this world. In fact, this is a core tenet of the Reformed tradition, of which you and I are heirs. The Heidelberg Confession, yeah, I went old school this week. The Heidelberg Confession that you will find in our denomination's Book of Order specifically addresses God overcoming our fears. It's a statement that was meant to contradict the church of the Middle Ages and its fascination with judgment to hell. It makes the following statement in the middle of its catechetical, I knew I missed that word, questions. The question is this: what comfort is it to you that Christ will come to judge the living and the dead? And the response: in all my sorrow and persecution, I lift up my head and eagerly await as judge from heaven
the very same person who before has submitted himself to the judgment of God for my sake and has removed all the curse from me. He will cast his and my enemies into everlasting condemnation, but he will take me and all his chosen ones to himself in the heavenly joy and glory. Yes, understanding and believing in God's perfect love towards us should keep us from fear of God's punishment. And yet, a lot of this passage, like most of the passages in 1 John, is not then about our behavior towards God, but instead towards our sisters and brothers, towards other people. If John is talking about fear of ultimate divine punishment, and it seems in part that he is, then how does this relate to our treatment of other people in the church? Or in the world generally? I suspect we already know the answer. We know that fearful people tend to be rather unpleasant people. Sometimes just downright nasty people. Now, not always, of course. Some who are deep down fearful are too sad to be unkind to others. Their fear leads them to retreat from life. Sometimes they escape in very harmful ways with drugs and alcohol and other self-harming behaviors. But with others, fear leads to anger and to hate. We've seen that in this world's history, and we've seen it in recent days. Today, we see groups of people who fear that the very foundations of what they hold dear are under attack. And out of this fear, these folks have become hate-filled, it seems. In the defense of what they view as the truth, they end up actually living at the extremes. But as the late politician and Senator Barry Goldwater said, extremism in the pursuit of even virtue is a vice. Alas, that is where much of our world is. We have a world in attack mode. This week, as I was reading some documents on social emotional learning and our young people, I discovered a report by a group called LIGHT. It's actually LGHT. It's an organization that monitors online harassment and hate speech. In their report, they said the following: there has been a 70% increase in cyberbullying in just the last few months. There has been a 40% increase in the toxicity on online gaming platforms. There has been a 900% increase in hate speech on Twitter directed toward China, those of Chinese descent, and Asian, American, and Pacific Islanders. And there has been over 200% increase in traffic to hate sites. Additionally, bullying, both cyber and in person, directed at people and students of color, of specific religious groups, of members of the LGBTQA+ communities, continue to rise. And we in the church, sadly, are not immune. I was devastated recently to discover a church in the community I call home decided to publicly shame and kick out of its fellowship a member they discovered was in a committed
same-sex relationship, choosing to attack her on the internet. Whatever the precise scenario, it happens too often in the church that one group attacks another, unkindly and often viciously. And because of technology, these days the ability to be cruel towards one another has been enhanced by the ability to leave faceless and anonymous comments on blog posts, on Facebook conversations, and on Twitter feeds. People who might not be unkind, or they actually talking to a person, find it just fine to lob accusations and epithets in digital print, often about people they have never even met. But actually, knowing someone or not knowing someone doesn't prevent many folks. And sometimes we all fall into this, don't we? From accusing people of things that if they took the time to get to know and love as a brother and sister in Christ, they would discover aren't true. Now, there are many explanations for a rise in all of this behavior. But if I were to come up with an answer, I would say that 9 times out of 10, if you trace back to its core, the reason people are hating in such a way, are acting in such uncivil manners, you would find that it was caused in some form or fashion by fear. Fear of losing. Fear of the stranger. Fear of having their belief, their view, their theology, their political position questioned or disproven. Fear that if this or that turns out to be true and their position not true, that their whole life and world might just collapse like that proverbial house of cards. And I think all of those fears can be turned back and traced to the fear that maybe somehow, God doesn't have the whole world in God's hands, like our children can so easily sing. A fear of scarcity over abundance. A belief that God is not the loving and gracious God that the church and scripture and the beloved disciples says John is. That maybe God really isn't love. Maybe my status in this world hangs by a thread, like that insect of Jonathan Edwards over the fire. And how can I ever really be sure that I'm saved and not damned? As one biblical commentator, Reverend Scott Hosey, states so powerfully, the less sure you are about God's unconditional love towards you and towards your neighbor, the greater you fear. And the greater you fear, the more likely it is you will find it hard to treat people with the love of Christ, because so much of life will feel threatening to you in the end. But to know God's perfect love is to be filled with that perfect love and all of the shalom and security and joy that go with it. There won't be room for fear and a heart filled to the brim with such joyful confidence. And from the overflow of that divinely inspired joy, there will come rivers of kindness and love towards our sisters and brothers. Friends, you cannot treat people unlovingly. Indeed, you cannot hate anyone if you are filled with God's spirit of love. Because when you are, there will be no room for fear that can make you lash out at another person. That kind of fear, friends, has been cast out, John writes. And what will remain will be the love of God through Christ Jesus our Lord. And friends, this is who we are meant to be at our very core. We are a product of God's love. John tells us that, if you remember it from last week's sermon, that love was there in the beginning. We simply need to walk with God and have faith and trust in the promises of our Lord. In the most famous of all Psalms, the 23rd, which we heard today, we hear that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, for God is with us. We simply need to walk with God and live accordingly. Now, I want you to know something. That doesn't mean that dangers aren't around. It simply means we have faith in God's promises and God's love. I want to leave you with this story. Once upon a time, there was a little girl who was woken up by a bad thunderstorm. She crawled out of her bed, as little girls are wont to do, and she went to her mother's bedroom, crawled into bed, and snuggled up with her. Immediately, she snuggled in and went back to sleep. While her mother lay there, feeling her soft and gentle breathing, a thought occurred to her that she expressed later this way: "As I lay there with her, I realized she hadn't asked me to make the storm go away, but just to stay with her. How many times, I wonder, out of my fear, have I asked God to take away the storms of life, when instead I simply needed to ask God to stay with me and help me weather the storms more peacefully." Friends, may we let love lead. May we let it lead us over fear. May we rest in God's promises that as God walks with us, even in our fears, that we will not be afraid, for God is with us. And may we share that love, that amazing love, with all the world, with the world that so desperately needs to know that love is greater than all our fears. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, alleluia. Amen. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we believe, help our unbelief, in Christ. Amen. As we continue in worship, let us confess that which we believe using the Apostles' Creed, found on page 14 or inside the front cover of your hymnal. I invite you, as you are able, to stand as we recite together that which we believe. Friends, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
for thanksgiving for all that we have received. Let us bring our gifts to God. A reminder that you can give in many ways. You can send a check to the church, donate online, or give back in other ways within your community. Now please stand and join me in the doxology, which is hymn number 592.
We come now to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Friends, you are invited to come to the table. This is not a Presbyterian table. This is the table of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, and all are welcome. All are invited to come. To come and feast in the fellowship of our Lord. In this sacrament of Holy Communion. Will you join Sydney now in our statement of faith as we recite it together?
We trust in God, the Holy Spirit,
everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, and sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the body of one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the Church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to amass idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people's long silence, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live boldly and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, come, Lord Jesus. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God and Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
My friends, on the night he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and after he
giving thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Eat, do this in remembrance of me." And likewise manner, he took the cup, and he said, This is the new covenant, found in my blood, given for your sins. Drink, do this in remembrance of me." My friends, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. You come to the table.
Please join me in prayer. Prayer to the people and the Lord, the merciful God, power and wonderful, eternal and present and graciously close. We are grateful for what you have given us in Jesus Christ, life and love without end. Prompted by your Spirit and encouraged by your faithfulness, we lift to you the cares and concerns of our hearts, the burdens and the worries of our lives. We pray that the sick would be healed, that the broken would be mended, that the mournful would be comforted. We pray that warriors would yield to peace, that leaders would gain wisdom, that the forsaken would be gathered in. We pray that the sorrowful would be consoled, that the poor would be lifted up, that the anxious would be released. We pray for children in their growing and for youth in their seeking. We pray for those making new starts and for those nearing the journey's end. We pray for those facing hard choices and for those enduring painful consequences. We pray for those filled with bitterness and for those who are just empty. We pray that your church might claim its potential, that the body of Christ might be strengthened by its many parts, that the work of ministry might be done with joy and thanksgiving. We pray for the courage to follow Jesus, for the faith to trust your promises to us, for the vision to see your kingdom among us even now. We pray for all that you would have us pray. We pray for those for whom no one prays. We pray all of these things in the name of the one ceaselessly praying for us, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Trusting in Christ, we offer together the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 485, "To God Be the Glory."
Thank you.
joined us in worship, and I noticed after worship he was looking out front for the candy bowl, which had, of course, disappeared after Sydney and I ate it all during the pandemic and had not been returned. Charles was concerned about this. He was very polite and didn't say anything, but I took care of him, and he was all right. I then later said I would be bringing chocolate back into the sanctuary, that he had reminded me of that. And lo and behold, church attendance has nearly doubled since I promised it. But as I have told people, if you sit through my sermon, you can get a piece of chocolate. You deserve that much. So it will be around back as you leave. But as you leave, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.